Member for Vancouver Mount Pleasant.
Honorable Speaker, Simgagat, Siginamanak, Gubawulsuk, distinguished guests, chiefs, and matriarchs, it is indeed an honor for me to be here today representing the constituents of Vancouver Mount Pleasant, a culturally diverse and proud community with an unwavering history as advocates who have and will continue to stand up for economic, social, and environmental rights and justice. I am the descendant of a strong, proud, determined, and resilient people. I am Niska, Gitxsan, Cree, Ojibwe, French, and Scottish. Honorable Speaker, until 1960, people like me weren't even allowed to vote and therefore participate in our parliamentary democracy 56 years ago. That may sound like a long time, but think of it this way. I am one of the first generations of First Nations and Indigenous people for whom voting has been a natural right since my birth. On February 17th, I became the first First Nations woman to be elected to serve in these chambers. I am proud to take my place alongside the extraordinary British Columbian trailblazers, all new Democrats, who came before me, that of Frank Calder, who was elected in 1949 as the first person of Aboriginal descent. Rosemary Brown was the first black woman. Emery Barnes was the first black man. Mo Sahota was the first Indo-Canadian. Jenny Kwan was the first Chinese person. Tim Stevenson was the first openly gay man. Carol James was the first Aboriginal Métis woman. Mabel Elmore was the first Filipino. Jane Shin was the first Korean woman. I want to say a few words about my journey to this house. My late Niska grandmother from the village of Lucklesap, Thelma Mark, attended St. Michael's Residential School when she was 10. It was the darkest days of her life, and notably the darkest chapter in our Canadian history, as Chief Justice Murray Sinclair illustrated in the Truth and Reconciliation Report and 84 Calls to Action. My late Gitxsan grandfather, William Woods, was given up for customary adoption when he was 3 and raised by the Mark family in Kitsagukla. He had the fortitude, to hide him from Indian agents when he was 9 years old. In fact, my maternal grandparents couldn't vote until they were 30 and 32 years old. We have come a long way given that Indigenous communities were on the verge of extinction. Remarkably, Aboriginal youth are the fastest growing population in Canada. When it comes time to Aboriginal rights and title enshrined in our Canadian Constitution, it is because of the relentless determination and unwavering rights-based advocacy approach of the Indigenous people across this province and across this country that we celebrate this progress. Again, we have come a long way, given that in 1887, my ancestors, members of the Niska Nation, made an epic journey from the Nass River to Victoria's Inner Harbour, determined to settle the land question. They were met by a premier who barred them from this legislature. Honourable Speaker, even in this House, we have come a long way towards reconciliation, considering that less than 20 years ago, the former leader of the then opposition BC Liberals and the current finance minister actually took the former NDP government to the Supreme Court of Canada to stop the Niska final agreement. Undoubtedly, we have a tremendously long way to go to see reconciliation in action. Before I continue, there is a universal saying, it takes a village to raise a child and a community to raise a leader. I want to take this time to acknowledge my mom and for all of the gifts that she's given me, my aunts Teresa Mark, Janice Mark, Lily Jorgensen, Jerry Bush, Jack Bush, for their unwavering love and generosity. To my daughters, Maya and Michaela, you are the sunshine in my life. Thank you for inspiring me each and every day to be a passionate, courageous advocate for change. To my team, I want to acknowledge, like all of you in this house, when you're involved in a rigorous campaign, I want to acknowledge my campaign managers, Kate Vamiermass and Nathan Allen, for their remarkable leadership and their generosity. I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge some of the superstars on my team who truly made February 2nd historic. That of Michael Cheevers, Mia Edbrook, Ashley Fair, Gala Milne, Jessica Smith, Samantha Monkton, Stuart Neatby, Andy Healy, Abby Leon, Cass Elliott, Ian Mass, Lynn Vamier, David Perry, Alda Diaza, Lester Obias, Leo Algendera, Mary Vaughn Delorme, Roberta Robertson, Clay Askey, Joshua Birdson, Clay Sedeby, Cassidy Kattemeyer, Jessica Boone, and Josh Naby. Thank you to Jenny Kwan for your 20 years of service on behalf of the people of Vancouver Mount Pleasant, and to the Vancouver Mount Pleasant Constituency Office for all of your support. Thank you to the Lacassine Drummers and Dance Group for reminding us all that the drum is the heartbeat of the people. It is my hope that we hear more drums in this house, Honourable Speaker. So why am I here? Why was I elected? I've been fighting bullies my whole life, and I'd like to acknowledge that we are acknowledging Anti-Bullying Day today. I've been a human rights advocate for the past 20 years. I have traveled this beautiful province and across Canada as an advocate for some of the most vulnerable, voiceless, and invisible people in our society. I've been a passionate child rights advocate for sexually exploited youth, youth in and from care. I worked alongside the Vancouver City Police to review the horrific circumstances that left a vulnerable homeless Aboriginal man, Mr. Frank Paul, in the alleyway of the downtown East Side, and who evidently died in police custody in an effort to make sure that such injustices don't ever happen again. I spent the last 8 years as an advocate at the Representative for Children and Youth Office to ensure that children, youth, and their families access the services that they so desperately deserve from the Ministry for Children and Family. I don't have enough time, Honourable Speaker, to speak about all the recommendations that have come out of this, out of that office, calling in to support the rights and interests of children that need services from the Ministry for Children and Family. Well, I waited almost 6 months for the by-election to be called, and the people of Vancouver Mount Pleasant went without an advocate. I took every opportunity to connect with the amazingly resilient constituents that live, work, and play throughout Strathcona, Chinatown, across Commercial Drive, Broadway, Main Street, and the downtown East Side, Chinatown, Gastown, and Railtown. I had the opportunity to hear from constituents about matters of the heart and the ongoing ultimatums they are faced with by this government. Time and time again, I heard concerns about the housing crisis and affordability concerns and issues. Parents and teachers concerned about seismic upgrades and class composition. Ongoing concerns about how we're going to protect the best coast from irreversible damage and to reduce our carbon footprint for our children, our children's children. I met with members of the vibrant arts community who feel like their contributions to the economy have been overlooked. I met with talented leaders in the tech sector who have a real chance to shine as the Silicon Valley in Vancouver Mount Pleasant. I met with so many small business owners that are proud of their artistry but fear they won't be able to keep the doors open and the lights on with increased taxes and hydro rates. I met with people who were concerned about the steady influx of gentrification and the concern about displacement. I talked to people about the importance of celebrating our diversity, like the festivals of the Lunar New Year Parade, and advocating for cultural retention and revitalization. We talked about the plans and the concerns around those plans for the St. Paul's Hospital that's coming to the Flats. We talked about the need for more housing. People brought their concerns to my attention, especially the students who are concerned about securing viable employment to pay off their student debt. I met with the craft breweries who see their work as truly a work of art. I met with first responders impacted by post-traumatic stress disorder. I met with so many parents functioning like ships in the night because they can't secure affordable and safe childcare. I met with human rights advocates saying yes to justice for persons on income assistance who are forced to live on $21 a week. I met with the survivors, families, and advocates who will not relent until justice is served for the missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls. The reality is, I don't have enough time, Honourable Speaker, to list all of the reasons why this budget is not balanced and how it has failed the people of Vancouver Mount Pleasant. For a minute, I was mildly optimistic that this government would deliver on something new. I almost bought the spin that the government would demonstrate leadership and pay it forward to restore public confidence, especially for the 98% of income earners that don't make $150,000 per year. Instead, this budget underscores the reason I put my name forward for nomination. When it comes time to report cards, the BC Liberals have failed the hardest working and most vulnerable citizens once again in this province. I can't comprehend why this government is so hell-bent on fighting First Nations in the courts, wasting the public's money instead of working with First Nations. I can't comprehend why I took too much ice. I can't comprehend why, pardon me. I can't believe this government is picking fights with the representative for children and youth and standing behind the Plekis report instead of cooperating with the independent office whose mandate it is to advocate for the best interests and rights of children and families throughout this province. This government seems to have an allergic reaction when it comes to accountability. Once again, our province stands alone in Canada as the only jurisdiction without a poverty reduction or housing strategy. I can't believe the finance minister and the premier have the audacity to say that the housing affordability crisis only affects a few neighborhoods. Not only has this government said no to increasing the rates for those on income assistance, they have cynically cut supports for persons with disabilities while claiming they've increased them. It boggles my mind why this government relies on balancing this budget at the cost of increased MSP and ICBC premiums, increased tuition and camping fees on the backs of average British Columbians without asking the rich to make a few little sacrifices along the way to ensure that at least some of the benefits of the provincial economy go to those who need them most. We have $100 million set aside for a prosperity fund funded by MSP tax. That's not good government or good business practice. It's just more spin. Moving forward, Honourable Speaker, the days of cowboys and Indians are over. The gold rush is a thing of the past, and LNG remains to be nothing more than a fantasy. So when I look forward, I look to a time that people won't have to fight so hard in the courts to have their most basic human rights met, to have a roof over their head, to access public education and health care, to be safe and protected from violence and harm. I look forward to working with the members opposite to revitalize the human rights framework as we collectively carry out the business of the day on behalf of all of British Columbians that are so desperately waiting for someone to stand up to balance the playing field. I look forward to seeing meaningful reconciliation in action and not just photo ops like the yoga event that was scheduled on National Aboriginal Day. I look forward to seeing some balance in our society, not just hearing about a balanced budget that's only balanced because of rampant real estate speculation in the Lower Mainland. I look forward to less talk about putting all of our economic eggs in the LNG basket and more talk and action towards a more diversified economy that serves the needs and interests of those living in urban ridings like Vancouver Mount Pleasant, as well as those who live and work in rural British Columbia. I know that government's job is not to make life easier, but surely, even in this House, we can agree that government's job is not to make life more difficult. I also know that people are not just files to be managed or deleted. Honorable Speaker, I have been fighting against discrimination my whole life. We need social, economic, and environmental certainty in this province. We need to have a vision built on a strong foundation of reconciliation with the Indigenous people of British Columbia. This is not solely for the interests of Indigenous people, but to benefit us all and all of our shared and common goals. This has been the most incredible journey in my life. The canoe that got me here was one that was filled with people that volunteered with so much generosity, that come from so many different backgrounds. We paddled together with a shared sense of optimism and hope that things are going to get better. So, as I conclude, Honorable Speaker, I'm privileged to be the descendant of a strong people. I'm privileged that I have the honor to be the voice on behalf of those who have been cast to the sidelines for far too long. I am privileged to bring a new voice of power to this arena on behalf of the people of Vancouver, Mount Pleasant, and throughout British Columbia. Thank you, Honorable Speaker.